and editor-in-chief of Microbial Beneficial Microbes. He received his PhD from the University of Groningen on the antimicrobial activity of bacteriocins produced by lactic acid bacteria in 1985. He pursued the health benefit activity of these microbes as a postdoc in North Carolina State University in USA, where he studied the potential of lab to function as carrier of vaccines. Thereafter, he was employed by TNO for more than 15 years, where he used the sophisticated dynamic computer-controlled in vitro models of the gastrointestinal tract, nicknamed TIM, to study the effect of functional foods and drugs on the colonic microbiota. So this lecture is a little bit longer. The subject is very interesting. So we'd like to thank you, Dr. Kuhn, for coming. We met last year at PrepRocin. I made the invitation and he accepted. So I'm so glad. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adriana, and thank you indeed for the invitation to be here. I should really shorten the CV because it takes time off my presentation, but I guess all of the other speakers, or most of the other speakers, are still having coffee, but they may have heard the presentation before. So actually, Adriana showed this already a little. Oh, sorry, I need to push a button. All right, this is it. This is Campus Venlo of Maastricht University, and this is the building that I work in. Most of what is on this slide, Adriana already explained. The reason I'm putting it up is indeed that I organized this series of conferences, and the next is end of this year in November in Amsterdam. So if you want to join, please feel free to do that. So I once gave a presentation in Hollywood, and after that I always talk about the script of the presentation, not about the outline or the content. No, it's the script. So this is the script of the presentation today. I will start on the TNO in vitro models of the gastrointestinal tract. And we have two models, TIM1 and TIM2. And with TIM2, I'll actually give a little intermezzo on microbiota. And then examples on the use of these models to investigate or improve probiotic survival, or to modulate the gut microbiota with prebiotics. So first about the in vitro models. So people always ask me, what does TIM stand for? And then I say it stands for the incredible machine. And that's not even true. It actually stands for a TNO in vitro model of the gastrointestinal tract, but it did not fit in the acronym, so we stuck with TIM. So these were developed by TNO, which is the Dutch Organization for Applied Scientific Research, since the late 1980s. And they had a number of requirements for these models. They wanted to simulate the successive dynamic conditions. They wanted to sample in time and at different locations. And the model had to be validated. So these are some of these successive dynamic conditions that occur in the GI tract. We have peristalsis throughout the GI tract. In the stomach, we have secretion of gastric acid and gastric enzymes. And depending on the type of meal, we have a certain emptying. I always say a glass of water travels through the system much quicker than a complete breakfast. Also, the meal is gradually delivered from the stomach to the small intestine. It's not dumped in there all at once, which is what a lot of researchers simulate when they do this in a beaker on a lab table. So gradually, the meal is delivered to the small intestine where the secretion of digestive enzymes and bile, and also there is a certain transit time, which again depends on the type of meal ingested. Then here there is absorption of digestion products and water, and then whatever is not digested and absorbed ends up in the colon, which contains a dense active microbiota, as we will see later, that actually ferments some of these components and produces microbial metabolites. Also, the colon has a certain transit, although that is less dependent on the type of meal, it's more a individual parameter. I usually freely share my physiological parameters with the audience. My transit is less than 24 hours. If you look in the literature, it's anything from 24 to 172 hours. And 172 hours is actually once a week. I don't really consider that normal anymore. I consider that constipated. So my opinion is that the one that is in front of the 72 is simply a typing mistake. So this is a picture of what we call TIM-1, which is the model for the stomach and the small intestine. So here we have the gastric compartments, and here the three parts of the small intestine, the duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. And actually, I'd like to explain it on the basis of this schematic, where again, here we have the stomach, duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. So these models consist of glass components with a flexible membrane inside, and in between, water of body temperature. So for humans, that is 37, for pigs, that's 39, for a chicken, it's 41. By applying pressure on the water, we get peristaltic movements. Come on. Yes. And by that, we mix and move the food through the whole system. Now, this mixing is better than if you would stir in a beaker, because there you frequently get phase separation of solids and liquids, unless you really stir very fast, but that's no longer physiological. So these peristaltic movements make sure that the meal is moved throughout the whole system. Now in the stomach we have a secretion of enzymes and acid, and then gradually the meal is delivered to the small intestine through a series of valves here, for which I also have a little video, but I'll explain it first with the picture here. So these are the three valves, and then first the first one opens up and the meal drops in. The second one opens up, the first one closes, the third opens, the second closes, and the third closes. I'll try to indicate that in the video as well. So this one opens up, that one opens up, this one closes, the third one opens, the second closes, and the third closes, okay? So in that sequence, this volume has been transferred from the upper to the lower compartment. And then the frequency of opening and closing is determined by the different meal that is ingested. So the frequency is higher with a glass of water than with a complete breakfast, for instance. So then part of the meal is here in the duodenum, where there's secretion of pancreatic enzymes and bile and bicarbonate to neutralize the gastric acid. And then through a similar series of valves here, here, and here, the meal is transported to the colon, or in this case, a sampling bottle. Now, connected to the jejunum and the ileum, we have these dialysis membranes, which take up digestion products and water. This really is an essential feature of the model. If you would not do that, then the enzymatic reactions would not lead to complete digestion, because they are always in equilibrium with the products that are produced. And by removing digestion products, we get almost complete digestion. So I talked about different meals and different parameters, and this shows some examples that we got from literature. And I always joke that this is what our PhD students look like when they start with us, bookworms to dig up the data that we need. But this is, for instance, an example for an adult on a liquid meal, let's say a glass of milk, where this curve here gives the amount of the meal that leaves the stomach in percentage. So you see that after about 2.5 to 3 hours, the stomach is empty. This red curve is the corresponding delivery of the meal to the colon, but in the meantime, that meal is digested, so only the undigested material actually follows that curve. Now the same adult, but now on a semi-solid meal, let's say a breakfast including orange juice or coffee, you can see that there is a delay in the delivery of the meal from the stomach to the small intestine and also from the small intestine to the colon. Also for babies, there are different parameters, not only with respect to transit, as you can see here, but also with respect to gastric pH, enzyme concentrations, and things like that. Now on the right here, this shows a plot, a screen capture of an experiment that we performed, where the symbols are the set point values for the stomach and for the small intestinal compartments, and then the squiggly line is the actual pH recorded during an experiment. So we see that on screen, so we immediately have quality control over the experiment. And you can see that with the red diamonds here, that the pH in the gastric compartment is not always 2. If you add a meal with a high buffering capacity, actually the pH starts at a relatively high value. And a lot of people actually do gastric incubations at pH 2 for 3 hours, which is definitely not physiological. Because in that 2.5 to 3 hours that I indicated here, the stomach is empty and only then it reaches a pH 2. Right? So the fraction of the meal that experiences a pH of 2 is negligible because most of it has already been gone on to the small intestine. All right, well then this is a picture of TIM2, which is the model of the colon. Actually, the picture is already old. We now have a model with 4 different units that we run in parallel. So again, I'd like to explain it on the basis of this schematic where we have the glass units with the flexible membrane inside for peristalsis. We have pH control, temperature control, volume control, and the model is flushed with gaseous nitrogen to make sure that it's completely anaerobic. Then this is a syringe which contains a medium that allows growth of the microorganisms that are present, which is chemically defined because we'd like to use the same medium over and over again, but in composition looks like what comes out of the small intestine. So it contains some residual protein that is not digested, some complex carbohydrates, some bile, etc. Now also here we have a dialysis system. In this case, it's running through the model because of the anaerobic requirements. And this dialysis system is unique in terms of models, but also is very much required. The microorganisms, they produce microbial metabolites, which I will come back to later on, short-chain fatty acids. And if you look in human individuals, there's a certain physiological range that you can find in the colon, which is from approximately 80 to 120 millimolars. So if we have our dialysis system on, we are in that physiological range. If we switch it off, we see a fast accumulation of these metabolites until it reaches a plateau, which basically means that these microorganisms have killed themselves by producing such high concentrations of metabolites. Now also in the body, they are taken up. So it really is essential to mimic this process. And by doing that, we can maintain an active microbiota for periods up to 3 weeks. Usually we only run a 5-day experiment. Right, so shortly after coffee, this is really not really a nice picture, but I need this to remind myself to tell you guys what we introduce in the model. This is what we use. I call this a fecal donation. My colleagues just call it shit. And obviously, if we mimic humans, we would collect it from the farmer and not from a cow, and then not on an ice cone. We do it nicely in a plastic box. But this is what we use. Essentially, all the bacteria that are present in our own body, we try to introduce into the system as well. So we have actually different systems available. It's all the same cabinets. But for humans, we have models for babies, adults, and elderly. And then usually we mimic a healthy population, but if we have literature data on patients, we can also mimic patients. Usually we take the average parameters of a population, but we can also look at the two extremes to see how the extremes in a population affect, for instance, survival of probiotics, and I'll have some examples of that later. Then we have a number of animal models. We have a dog model called FIDO, Functional Intestinal Dog Model. I don't remember who came up with that, but I like it. We have a pig model. We have a pre-ruminant calf. A cow has 4 stomachs and it is a ruminant, right? It ferments in the stomach. But a pre-ruminant calf only uses 1 of those 4 stomachs, so we can actually simulate it with our model. Now, these were the systems that were already available at TNO. And in my new job at the university, we actually changed the model to a chicken model, which, and the next joke is only understandable for European people, but it's dubbed Calimero, and this is a character that's known in Europe, but apparently not so much here in Brazil. But Calimero stands for Chicken Elementary Tract Model, okay? Now, I mentioned that TNO started to mimic the GI tract with these models, and they had a number of requirements. They wanted to simulate the successive dynamic conditions, so we can do that. They wanted to sample in time and at different locations. We can do that too. And the third requirement was the validation of the systems. So this list is not even complete, but the upper GI tract model has been validated with respect to protein, carbohydrate, and fat digestion, survival of probiotic microorganisms, as I will show later on, uptake of both fat-soluble and water-soluble vitamins, and so on. So we've done comparison between TIM and either a clinical or a human, a clinical or an animal trial, and then we showed that the data was very similar. For TIM2, it has been slightly more difficult to validate that because we don't really have access to the colon. I mean, a gastroenterologist can take a tube and stuff it down your throat or up the other end, which both are not very pleasant. If they stuff it down your throat, it has to be at least 6 meters long to reach the colon. Up the other end, usually what they do is they clean the colon of the contents, and the contents are exactly what we are interested in, so that's not really a good situation for us. So TIM2 has been validated on the basis of what is called sudden death individuals. People that died because of a heart attack or a road accident or were shot. Hopefully not by health professionals, but you never know nowadays. And that data was used to develop the model with respect to the composition and the activity of the microbiota. So this is the intermezzo on microbiota. I think you're all aware of the fact that the gut microbiota has been implicated in a number of different diseases and disorders. Not surprisingly, they are involved in things that are wrong in the GI tract, like colon cancer or inflammatory bowel disease, or even irritable bowel syndrome, but also things that are distantly, at least microbiologically speaking, far away from the gut, right? Like allergy of skin and lungs. They play a role in obesity. Oh, I blame my gut microbes. with associated cardiovascular diseases, also type 1 diabetes and other diseases. They play a role in longevity and things related to the brain, as also alluded to by our previous speaker already. Now, I work together with a group in Canada that has a rat model on autism. And I will show two little videos of rats in a second, where the only difference between those two rats is that one metabolite that is produced by the gut microbiota has been injected directly into the brain of the autistic rat, which leads to changes in behavior. So this is a normal, happy rat, and this is the behavior of an autistic rat. It shows repetitive behavior as autistic children also do. And it will keep running in circles until the metabolite either has been used or dialyzed out of the brain, and then return more or less to a normal rat again. Now, I'm not suggesting that parents that have autistic children inject something in the brain of their children. That's not the case, right? But you can imagine that there are underlying metabolic problems in these children that allow that metabolite to reach the brain and cause these behavioral issues. And actually, they've also shown biochemical changes in the brain. So usually I introduce gut microbiology with this slide that I got from Rod Mackey in the US, which he calls sound bites. I don't know why, because a sound bite is a little fragment of music and then you have to guess what song it is. But it's his slide, so it's called sound bite. And the first one says that the number of bacteria that we have in the colon outnumber our own cells by a factor of 10, right? So we are actually 90% bacteria, only 10% human. Some people get an identity crisis out of that. I can live with it by now, but it's about a kilogram that we carry with us each day. Apparently, we excrete our own weight in bacteria per year in the toilet. I have no idea why that is relevant, but and then Glenn Gibson, the other guy here on the in the lower right corner, I always used to say, being a university professor, he had time to calculate that at the age of 70, that's the weight of 12 elephants. Again, no idea why that is relevant, but it's a whole pile of shit, I can tell you that. About 50% of what we deposit in the toilet is bacteria in terms of solids. Another one, each person has more bacteria in the colon than the number of people that has ever been on this planet. So what I'm trying to say is these are staggering numbers of bacteria, 10 to the power 14, 100 times a million times a million. So most of these actually we cannot culture in the lab because we don't know what their growth requirements are, at least not as a single isolate. We can culture them when they are, you know, this mixed fecal donation, that's not a problem. But as a single isolate, that's very difficult. But there are estimates that there are between 400 and 1,000 or maybe even more than 2,000 different species in the population based on molecular DNA tools that we have. I'll get back to that in a second. Each individual, however, has approximately between 200 and 250 different species. So that already shows that the microbiota composition of an individual is actually individual specific. So the major activities of what they do in the colon is carbohydrate fermentation and protein fermentation, simply because those are the majority of substrates that make it to the large intestine. So on carbohydrate fermentation, they produce these short-chain fatty acids that I already alluded to earlier, and some gases. The short-chain fatty acids are acetate, propionate, and butyrate. Sometimes we see accumulation of lactate, but only if fermentation is fast. If it is slow, then it is converted into the short-chain fatty acids. Also, we get production of some gases, and generally this is considered to be health beneficial, hence the little smiley. However, again, if fermentation is fast, and if production of gases is also fast, then you may get gas accumulation, you may get rumbling, you may get bloating, perhaps even a little pain, which is not really pleasant. But also, it's not toxic, as compared to protein fermentation, which leads to all kinds of toxic metabolites, hence the little devil over here. So we have these branched-chain fatty acids, which are actually produced from branched-chain amino acids and are therefore a marker for protein fermentation. We have ammonia, all kinds of phenolic structures, and these rather smelly silver-containing metabolites, hydrogen sulfide and methane thiol. Now, these metabolites are actually really important in health and disease. For butyrate, we know that this is the most important metabolite produced by the gut microbiota. It has been estimated that 70% of the fuel used by epithelial cells of the colon comes from microbes. In fact, humans do not produce butyrate. So if there's a lack of butyrate, the epithelial cells get into trouble. You may get translocation of microorganisms with infection and sepsis and whatnot. Also, butyrate has been shown to reduce cancer promotion in transformed tissue by induction of differentiation, although this has been only shown in vitro cell cultures, has not been confirmed clinically yet. These silver-containing metabolites from protein fermentation, on the other hand, they block the use of butyrate by those colonocytes. So even if there is butyrate present, if at the same time you have hydrogen sulfide or methane thiol, you still get into trouble, your gut epithelial cells do. So the balance between protein and carbohydrate fermentation becomes really important. And if you look at those two phenomena, then in the proximal colon, in the beginning, we primarily see carbohydrate fermentation. And this is because if there's protein present, these microbes would like to incorporate this into their own enzyme machinery. But as they travel along the GI tract, fermentable carbohydrates become depleted, and then they switch to protein fermentation with the concomitant production of these toxic metabolites. And also in the distal colon, we usually see the onset of colon cancer and IBD, which may then spread through the rest of the body. So there seems to be a correlation between those two. All right. This is the molecule that is used in as a molecular DNA tool to indicate which microorganisms are present in the gut microbiota. It's the small subunit ribosomal RNA, or 16S rRNA molecule, which is a part of ribosomes, and therefore it's a universal molecule because it's present in all bacteria. But it contains variable and constant regions. And actually, the variable regions contains a sort of a fingerprint, a DNA nucleotide sequence that by which you can actually identify the bacteria. So it's used to identify them to the level of the species. And this is the three-dimensional structure of that molecule with all the variable regions indicated. In determining which microbes you have in using this molecule as a identity marker, it kind of depends a little if you can actually go to the level of the species depending on which variable region you sequence. But that molecular marker is used as a tool to study the composition of the gut microbiota, and this is one of the first studies which used that. And actually over an age period. And mind you, this is not the same individual followed for 80 years. These are different individuals, but anyway. So when we are born, you can see we are, and these are the number of different microorganisms that are found in samples. When we are born, you can see we are practically sterile. So this is blown up here. Over the first 3 to 4 years, actually the microbiota actually becomes adult-like already. It becomes a stable ecology. Now clearly the children at 4 years are not adult-like yet, but the microbiota already is, okay? So over adulthood it is more or less stable. But what you can see here is that three different populations were studied. A Western population in the US, then Amer Indians and people from Malawi, and that is summarized here that the number of different microorganisms that you find in those populations is significantly different. And it looks like in Western population, we have actually lost microbes that are still present in populations that have a different diet or different environmental practices. And one of the theories actually in why we have developed all these Western diseases is that some of the important microbes that prevent those are lost in our population. So if the microbiota is individual specific, then can we talk about a normal microbiota? Well, people have looked at that, and this is a study published in Science where they found that if you take a cutoff of in 90% of the individuals, we have 57 species that are in common. Okay, so that means that another 200 species are actually quite variable between different individuals. If you translate that to the number of genes, it's about 250,000, but there they already dropped the percentage level to 50% of the individuals. But there is a difference between composition and function. So these are a number of individuals where at a high phylogenetic level the microbiota composition has been determined, and yeah, you can see that there are differences between individuals, right? However, if you look at the functional prediction of what these microbes can do in these individuals, there actually is a lot of overlap. So even though the composition is different, there is enormous functional overlap between the different microbes, which leads to a very similar potential for functional capacity. I always say that, you know, to go from glucose to acetic acid, there's maybe a handful of biochemical routes that you can do that. And if you have 250 microbes, there has to be enormous functional overlap to be able to do that. So this is a larger study where each column here is a different individual where the gut microbiota has been analyzed. And for a while, we thought that the ratio between Bacteroidetes in green or Firmicutes in red was important. But you can see here that the person on the left here is almost exclusively colonized by Firmicutes. Whereas here on the right, the person is almost exclusively colonized by Bacteroidetes. And anything in between, right? So there's enormous variation between different individuals. Also, there's geographical differences. I got this slide from Miguel Guimonda, so he looked at a number of companies in Europe. And he always makes the joke that, so here in Italy, independent of what age you take, you have high levels of bifidobacteria, which we consider to be important for health. In Germany, it's lower. So he says, so what happens if you increase the bifidobacteria populations in Germany? Do they become more healthy, or do they turn into Italians? Well, I'm not sure how Germans are in Italians, what they think about the joke, but I like it. But the key point is that there are geographical differences even in microbiota composition. So if you look at that core microbiota, those 57 species that were present in 90% of the individuals, which are listed here, then this actually shows the variation in abundance of these microbes within the population. So there are a few where there is an enormous bandwidth, and this is log factor, of the abundance of these microbes in the individuals. So even though it is present, it is never at the same amount present in each person. So there's a lot of variation. And some of these microbes have been shown to be linked in networks together, which means that if one microbe is present, it's highly likely that another one is there as well. And sometimes these are actually anti-correlated. When one microbe is present, you never find another one. So we are slowly starting to learn about these. But if you look at that core microbiota, then old acquaintances are not found in this core microbiota. What I mean by that is that the bad and the ugly, E. coli or Salmonella, not in the core microbiota. But also the good ones, Bifidobacteria and Lactobacillus, you do not find in those 57 species. In fact, Bifidobacterium is found around the 75th position, and Lactobacillus is below the level of detection. Yet both the good, the bad, and the ugly are considered to be very important for health and disease, right? So just the core microbiota doesn't tell you anything about whether you're healthy or not. Now, this composition of the gut microbiota has been looked at to see if there are correlations between the composition and disease. And this is a so-called principal coordinate analysis plot, where each data point, which is at the end of the line here, is the composition of one person's gut microbiota. So 250 species put into a single data point. Then if you plot it in such a plot, you can see that the composition of healthy individuals is different from people with ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease. And even within IBD, which is UC and CD, you can see that there are differences between the gut microbiota, okay? Now the question became, what is the chicken and the egg? Did we first have a change in gut microbiota that led to inflammation, or did we first have inflammation that led to a change in gut microbiota? And we're not really sure about that in this case. What we do know is that there are differences, for instance, in the number of genes that are present in the gut microbiota. Or in particular species that are higher in healthy individuals than in people with IBD, in this case for Faecalibacterium prausnitzii. So we do start to see correlations between health and disease, but these are not cause and effect relationships yet. This is obesity, where again in such a principal coordinate analysis plot, the gut microbiota of lean individuals clusters more or less to the bottom right. Then overweight individuals are in the middle and obese individuals in the upper left corner, okay? So there seems to be some sort of a gradient in gut microbiota composition from lean to obese. Now also here the question was, what is the chicken and the egg? So here actually what has been done is fecal donations from a lean individual have been taken and have been transplanted into a germ-free mouse. And then if it was taken from a lean individual, the mouse remained lean. If it was taken from an obese individual, the mouse became obese, okay? So it looks like there is a change in microbiota that actually leads to obesity. So in this picture, the chicken comes first. And this chicken says, yes, I knew it, chicken comes first. But that's in an English dictionary, it doesn't work in a Dutch one, there's the other way around. Okay, so pre and probiotics, we are very interested in that. So how come we don't have more successful products on the market that actually influence health and disease? After more than three decades of intensive research, the truly effective products can be counted on the fingers of two hands, or if you're an animal, two paws. We really need more research into the effect of these components on health and disease and on the gut microbiota. So there may be actually a lot of confounding factors when taking it from a pre-clinical phase to a clinical phase. As I said, we mostly have these correlations between microbiota composition and disease, but no cause and effect studies yet. So this is just an example of some of the confounding factors that could be present in the clinical trial, where actually I want to focus on this part here on the probiotic supplement in a separate slide. As we heard from the previous speaker, strain matters, right? There's strain dependency not only in probiotic activity, but also in vitamin production, which may actually be a probiotic trait as well. The dose that is used matters, and there are very few dose response studies. Survival in the GI tract matters. The duration of providing a probiotic actually matters, and there has been a large spread of different durations that have been used. The method of administration, whether that is in a yogurt drink, a capsule, that's a weird one, a tablet, a capsule, or a powder. The moment of intake, whether that is during a meal, prior to a meal, or after a meal. And I will actually have some examples of some of these. And actually also we've shown that genome stability is important. Some of my colleagues at TNO, they isolated Lactobacillus rhamnosus GG from a commercial product at the time that the patent on GG expired, and they wanted to use it in Africa to help people there in a cost-effective way to actually also use probiotics. And then they sequenced the genome of the isolates that they had. And they found that in 70% of the isolates, a mutation occurred in this region of the genome, where either the blue part or the pink part of the genome had been kicked out of the genome. Now this actually encodes the pili, which are thought to be important in adhesion of Lactobacillus GG to the epithelial cells, and might actually be a probiotic trait. So this product with 70% mutants may not be such a good product anymore. Okay, so then I'll switch to examples of the use of these models in research for probiotics and prebiotics. And actually most of the examples that I have is on human application, although we also do have a lot of examples on animal applications. It just happened to be that I could quickly find these. And the first thing I want to show is our validation study on the survival of probiotics. So in TIM or in humans, we looked at survival of probiotics at the end of the small intestine. So in this case, that meant that in the human volunteers, indeed a tube was stuffed, I always say, down their throat or the nasal cavity until the end of the small intestine. And this is an X-ray of it. So the catheter comes from the oral cavity here, and I always lose track of it, so I do something like this. And then it ends up here in the distal ileum. And this little white thing here is actually a balloon that you can inflate. And then through natural peristalsics, the tube is drawn into the GI tract. And then you deflate it again if you're eating to let the food pass, and then inflate it again. So it takes 48 hours before it's here. Okay. Then through the tube, samples were given a product using or containing bifidobacteria or Lactobacillus acidophilus. And then through the tube, samples were taken over time and then plated for viable microorganisms. And the same was done at the end of TIM1, which is the corresponding position as here, and also plated for viable counts. And you can see that there is a very good correlation between in vivo and in vitro. So now we actually have data for a handful of strains where this was compared, and we always see a perfect alignment. So we actually now use the model to predict what happens in a clinical situation. Now I talked about average parameters and the two extremes, right? And this is an example of where we investigated extremes in terms of gastric delivery, the time it takes for the foods to leave the stomach. That can be fast or slow. If it is slow, then logically you can infer that the survival of probiotics is reduced because they are exposed to a longer period to gastric acid. But we can actually put numbers to that. We can determine what the spread in the population is, and if we take the average parameters, the curve would run like that. So we can determine, we can predict in a clinical trial what would be the two extremes of what you find in terms of survival for both the different strains that we used here. Same is true for bile concentrations. Not everybody excretes the same amount of bile. So here we checked normal concentrations and low bile. Again, logically, you can deduce that at low bile concentrations, survival will be higher because these microbes are killed to a lesser extent, but we can actually put a number to that, okay? So this allows us really to look at individual parameters and how they influence survival of microorganisms. This is another example. This is Lactobacillus plantarum WCFS1. And this is a EM picture when it was taken from an MRS culture. And then it was fed to TIM1, and samples were taken at the end of the model and plated for viable counts. Also there, we took a AM photograph, and you can see that the surface of these microbes is completely different. Okay, so they are really affected by enzymes, acid, and bile as they travel through the GI tract. Now, usually what we do in other in vitro experiments where we may incubate these cells with immune cells or epithelial cells, we use these happily grown cells in MRS broth, right? But this is actually what they look like in our GI tract. So these are the cells that actually interact with epithelial cells. So we think that these cells are a much better fraction of cells to use than these happily growing MRS cells in determining interaction with epithelial cells or immune cells, and maybe a better prediction for what happens in real life. Now also here, the survival of this strain was compared in a human clinical trial and in TIM, and we found 1% more, but it's very close to the 7% found in the human trial. Actually, in this particular case, these cells were radiolabeled, so we could also determine how the total amount of bacteria traveled through the GI tract system and determine the percentage of survival in that way. Now, to indicate that these characteristics are strain-dependent, I have this slide here. We tested 5 different strains of Lactobacillus casei, and we tested them only in the stomach. So we disconnected the small intestine, which is very easy in our system, but try doing that in humans. And we tested them in the whole stomach small intestinal model. Now, if you first look at the experiments in the stomach, then strain E here survives approximately 20%, which is not bad for a probiotic, whereas strain A is 5% survival after the gastric compartment, okay? So A apparently is quite sensitive to gastric acid, whereas E is less sensitive. If you then look at the data from the whole small intestinal model, then strain A, which was at 5% here, is still at 5% after the complete model. So even though it was very sensitive to gastric acid, it doesn't give a damn about bile and pancreatic juice, okay? Whereas strain E, which was relatively resistant to gastric acid, now drops to 2%. So it's quite sensitive to bile and pancreatic enzymes. And just by knowing the sensitivity to the different parameters that occur in the GI tract, you can use to develop products. Strain A here, you might want to protect against gastric acid to allow it to reach the small intestine where it doesn't mind about the parameters anymore there. So that was done by this company, Merck. They actually developed a tablet on the basis of experiments that were performed in our in vitro model. They had a powder that contained three different probiotics where survival was very low. And they decided to develop a coating around the tablet that would protect it against exposure in the gastric acid. So the composition of the coating and the thickness of the coating was developed using our model to come up with the best available product, which is now on the market in Europe and Latin America. So in laptops, you have this sticker on it that says Intel inside, right? So this is a product that has TIM inside. This is developed using our TIM model. I'm very proud of that. Same company, but now a product for our children. So these tablets are quite big. Children are unable to swallow those. So they developed a chewable tablet. But clearly, it's no use to have a coating around it. If you chew it with your teeth, then the coating breaks. So what they did here is they actually determined when you should ingest this tablet to have optimal survival of your probiotics. Should that be during a meal or after a meal? So this is, again, experiments just in the stomach. And you can see that if you give it during the meal, the survival is higher than if you do it 1 hour after a meal. And this is because the meal has this buffering capacity, but 1 hour after the meal, the pH has already dropped and these microbes become more sensitive, okay? So this is after the stomach, this is after the complete model, and there the difference is even more drastic. Survival is higher during the meal than 1 hour after the meal, okay? So the labeling on the carton, the package, now says that you should ingest this during a meal. I have no idea how many people actually read that and do it, because I don't read those those texts, but this is what the label says now. Now, this is an example that is still puzzling us. What we have done here, actually I'd like you to focus on this part of the graph. What we have done here is we have tested probiotics singly, so NCFM or BIO7 or in combination. And this was a protocol for babies which get fed every 3 hours, so there's data for both meals. But just look at the data here. So if we look at survival of NCFM by itself, it is in the order of 18% or so. If it is combined with BIO7, survival is increased to approximately 32. We have no idea why that is. Also the other way around, survival of BIO7 by itself is 35 or something. It is increased in the presence of NCFM. So one way or another, these microorganisms influence one another in with the result of an increased survival. We have no idea why that is. We are studying this now with gene arrays to see what happens. Also here, focus on this part of the slide. Here we combined probiotics with prebiotics. So the idea is that if you provide these probiotics with a substrate, a prebiotic, then they may start to grow in the GI tract and you get higher numbers, right? So NCFM by itself is here. If you provide it with fructooligosaccharides, either low or high dose, we actually saw a reduced survival. For BIO7, low dose, reduced survival. Only at a high dose, we saw an increased survival, okay? So our hypothesis now is that if you use these cells alone, they have probably been cultured to stationary phase where they express stress proteins that actually cross-protect against gastric acid and bile and things like that. If you give them something to feed, they actually get out of that stationary phase and back into a logarithmic growth phase where the expression of these stress proteins is lower and therefore the protection against acid and bile also is lower, which leads actually to a lower survival rather than a higher one. Now, in the case of bifidobacteria, the idea is that this low concentration leads to a reduction in survival with the same mechanism, but if you increase the concentration of fructooligosaccharides, and if they are very efficient, you see what appears to be an increase in survival, but actually is first a drop in survival, but then an outgrowth of the cells that remain in the GI tract alive to levels that are actually apparently above survival of the strain by itself. Also, this we are looking into a gene arrays to see whether we can explain that in more detail. A similar example from a Brazilian researcher that spent some time in my lab here, where if you use Lactobacillus sobrius with a prebiotic, in this case we actually see an increase in survival of the strain during the GI tract. Also here, if you combine it with another probiotic, BB12, we again see the increase in survival, which we don't really understand what is happening there. There's no name on here. There should also be a name here. This is from another Brazilian researcher, Monica Kruger. What she looked at is a Lactobacillus casei strain that produces a bacteriocin. If you look at the survival of the strain by itself, it survives approximately 4.5%, which is not extremely high, but it's still okay. If you look at survival in combination with Enterococcus faecium, the final result is the same, 4.5%, but the kinetics are completely different. Again, something we don't understand, that we want to look into why this is the case. But more importantly is this slide, actually, where if you look at Enterococcus by itself, survival is quite high. It's more than 250%, which means it actually grows under the conditions that we applied. It can multiply in the GI tract. But combined with this Lactobacillus casei, which produces a bacteriocin, it's actually below the level of detection. So the Lactobacillus actually kills the sensitive Enterococcus faecium strain. So we tried to detect the bacteriocin in this situation, but the peptide could not be detected. So also here we switched to molecular DNA tools and microarrays to see if we can figure out a mechanism here. Then one last example of the upper GI tract, where we look at the effect of probiotics on protein digestion. Now this is our validation study on protein digestion. In this particular case where we compared fistulated pigs and TIM, where TIM also mimicked pigs in this particular case. And you can see that this straight line is the perfect correlation between in vivo and in vitro. And for all the different protein sources that we tested, we are very, very close to that perfect correlation, right? So again, we use the model to predict protein digestion in pigs or humans for that matter. So what we have done here is we looked at protein digestion with a very crude analytical parameter. We looked at alpha amino nitrogen. So if you have a peptide of four amino acids, then the alpha amino nitrogen is here and you get a value of one. If you have individual amino acids, you get a value of four, okay? If you look at total nitrogen using Kjeldahl, both the peptide and the four individual amino acids have a score of four, and you can look at the ratio of those. So the ratio here is 1:4, here is 1:1. And now it doesn't really tell you a lot about the distribution of the peptides in your sample, because both these two examples have an AN value of 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but they have a range of a single amino acids to a peptide of four amino acids. Here it's also 7, but here the range is 1 to 2, okay? So it is a crude measure of protein digestibility, but it does tell you something. So what we did subsequently is we used Bacillus coagulans BC30 and looked at plant protein digestion. Plant proteins are quite lowly digestible, and we actually could see that if you use Kjeldahl total nitrogen, that we could increase plant protein digestion. If you look at the alpha amino nitrogen group, we could almost double or more than double that. indicating that the fragments became smaller. So this ratio shows that there's an increase in protein digestion, plant protein digestion, if we use BC30. So we're now studying other probiotics to see if we have the same. Actually, in the next study, we looked at all the individual amino acids and all the dipeptides that were produced. And if you sum all of the 20 amino acids together, you get this profile, although there were clear differences in the profile of some individual amino acids and also for dipeptides. But clearly, there's an increase in protein digestion if we add this probiotic strain. So potentially a good combination to eat with plant proteins. In the same experiments where we analyzed individual amino acids, we also looked at biometabolism, where the BC30 actually increased the concentration of all these large blue balls of different bile acids. So in fact, this strain may also be effective in reducing cholesterol, although that should be studied in more detail mechanistically. Right, then I want to switch to examples for the colon. Still time. So how do we study the gut microbiota? Well, this is usually what we do, right? We study these fecal donations. And this apple, you know, it can travel through the GI tract and experience all those nice parameters that are there, and it will see all of those parameters, but we can't really do that as a human. We can't crawl in the GI tract, although this picture suggests otherwise. It's simply not possible, right? So that's one of the reasons why TNO developed these systems. And so we have used TIM2 to study gut microbiota. What I didn't say with the picture with the cow and the ice cone is that we actually usually pool fecal donations to create what we call a standardized microbiota, so we can do experiments over up to 100 different experiments with the same pool. But the reviewers of our papers always asked us, but what are you creating if you pool these samples? Well, I say if we take samples from 10 individuals, we create individual number 11, because there's always some differences. One of my PhD students asked the question, to pool or not to pool? That actually is the title of her paper. And she took four different individuals and tested them separately in the model and also the pool of their fecal samples. And you can see, based on the short-chain fatty acid production, there is not a lot of difference between the individuals or the pool. So this is why you know we consider that we can use a pool, certainly if we look at short-chain fatty acid production. Also with microbiota composition, we saw that there was a very similar profile, although within the pool you see certain peaks of microbes that actually you can indicate that this peak came from individual 4, this one came from individual 3, and things like that. But overall, functionally, as I said, there's enormous functional overlap, so we decided to use a pool. Also, we always do our experiments in duplicate. I hate statistics. With N is 2, you cannot do statistics, so I do duplicates. But the reviewers always asked us, is there a statistical significant difference? And we say, well, you know, the model is computer controlled, so it's very reproducible, so believe the data. Well, they didn't want to, so the same PhD students, to shut up those reviewers for once and for all, and I hope there's no reviewers in the audience, but we did NS4, okay? And, well, this shows the standard deviation, and sometimes the standard deviation is not even visible because it's smaller than the symbol used in the graph. But it is really reproducible, and we actually used three different diets here. A normal diet that we use in experiments, one high in carbohydrates and one high in protein. So high in protein, you see that the production of short-chain fatty acids is much lower, and this is because these microbes need to also incorporate some of that protein in their biomass, so there is less available for production of short-chain fatty acids. For ammonia, which is a metabolite from protein fermentation, actually is the reverse. This is our normal control situation. On a high protein diet, it's higher. On a high carbohydrate diet, it is actually significantly lower. So remember that balance between carbohydrate and protein that I talked about in the GI tract? It really is important to get to a low production of these toxic metabolites. So with this NS4 study, we now reply to the reviewers, oh, we've done that study before, and we show a very low standard deviation, so we stick to duplicates. But this study also allowed us to actually correlate the high carbohydrate, the normal, or the high protein diet to certain microorganisms that were increased or decreased under these conditions. And that correlation is shown here. In fact, we could also correlate these microorganisms to the different metabolites that were produced and either positively or negatively correlate it to those. So it actually tells us quite a lot about which microbes are involved in the final outcome in production of metabolites. This is an example that shows that how a carbohydrate is fermented over time in the system. Now, this happens in the proximal colon. If you would want to study this in humans, you would have to do an invasive study with a gastroenterologist to reach that site. Because if you wait until this sample ends up in the toilet, I'll show you what you'll see. So this is a HbA1c profile of a TIM sample before addition of a carbohydrate. And you see some peaks there. If we add the carbohydrate, then 15 minutes later, this is the profile that we see. Okay, so that soluble carbohydrate leads to a lot of different peaks. If we follow that over time, after 2 hours, 6 hours, 24 hours, it's completely fermented, right? So this 24-hour sample is what you would get if you wait until a person goes to the bathroom and delivers this fecal sample that was fed in the proximal colon. So you don't really see anything anymore. You can't take the samples in between. So this is a very powerful way of looking at the degradation of a carbohydrate. This is an example where we studied not only the fermentation of a fiber, but also how it affects the immune system. And what we showed here that the arabinin part of pectin, which usually is branched, if you have a linear version of that, it has a different influence on the immune system. Right, so the linear version increased IL-10 compared to branched. No change here, but it also increased IL-12 and IL-4. So these microorganisms in the gut actually produce this linear version of arabinin. So they may actually, through that, also influence the immune system. So apart from my personal interest in obesity, also globally, it really is a problem, right? So we started to look at that. And we've done experiments where we have taken fecal donations from lean individuals or obese individuals and introduced those in our system. And our hypothesis was that the obese microbiota actually extracts more energy from the diet in the form of these short-chain fatty acids. So we measure the short-chain fatty acids. We multiply that with the amount of kilocals per, or kilojoules in this case, per mole present to get to a total amount of energy extracted. And our hypothesis was that the obese microbiota would extract more than the lean. However, that was not the case. Okay. So for galacto-oligosaccharides, the energy extraction is actually more or less equal. Although there is a large difference in the individual short-chain fatty acids that are produced by the two different microbiotas. Overall, in terms of kilojoules, there's no difference. Only for lactulose, we saw that the obese was higher than lean, as indicated here. Now, this may seem a very small increase, but I'll get back to that hopefully by the end of the talk, if there's time, to show you how significant even this small increase is. For the two pectins, lean was actually much higher than obese, here for apple pectin, here for sugar beet pectin. So that made us think, which is what you usually should do before an experiment, but we did not expect this. And our idea now is that the obese microbiota is not really used to ferment pectins from fruit and vegetables. so it doesn't know how to deal with the substrate. So what we want to do now is do a longer incubation to see if we can actually flip the obese microbiota into extracting more energy from this substrate as well. So one of my other students, she's actually Brazilian, and she has a scholarship from CMPQ. She looks at what I call waste from food processing. Now, if I say waste in the face of my industrial partners, thank you, 10 minutes. If I say waste, they slap me in the face. No, no, it's not waste. It's a byproduct or it's a rest product. Well, this is from cassava after starch extraction. And I've been told that it's just thrown into the environment. If I cannot call that waste, then I don't know what I can call waste. So I will keep saying waste. So she looked at the gut microbiota composition of the cassava waste and compared it to a classical prebiotic inulin. And I'm actually focusing here on bifidobacteria, where we saw a dramatic increase in the abundance of bifidobacteria, even higher than the classic prebiotic inulin. Now, this is in lean individuals. So she then wanted to test that in obese individuals. And we did still see an increase, but it was not higher than inulin, and it certainly wasn't a factor of 1700. But still, it's very promising as a substrate to increase bifidobacteria also in obese individuals. So this was her first result, and she took that a little bit further into looking at different batches of cassava flour, comparing it to inulin, but also looking at orange peel and passion fruit peel to see what the potential prebiotic nature of these compounds are. So this is again is one of these principal coordinate analysis plots, in this case three-dimensional, where we look at the final data point in the experiments and have actually, if you then look at primary substrate, you see that all the starch-containing substrates cluster in the middle, pectin-containing ones cluster to the left, and inulin clusters to the right. So using these type of analyses, it's very powerful to see how the microbiota composition changes on different substrates, okay? Now, our hopes were that, so the obese microbiota is this dotted area here, that the obese microbiota would actually shift into the area of the lean microbiota. So using these waste products, that was not accomplished. So we are continuing our search for an optimal waste product to accomplish that and to see if we can change the obese microbiota into a more healthy lean one. Using all kinds of bioinformatic platforms, you can actually indicate at specific microorganisms that are stimulated on these particular substrates, and you get these very nice presentations of microbes that are specifically stimulated, for instance, with inulin, which, not surprisingly, are bifidobacteria. Oops. This is an example where we have used fecal donations from chronic kidney disease patients. A study with Radboud University in the Netherlands, where in a previous study we have shown that if we add iron to the gut microbiota, actually we increase pathogenic microorganisms. So in a follow-up study, we decided to use a prebiotic to see if we could reduce the pathogen increase. Apart from the pathogen increase, we actually also saw an increase in toxic metabolites. So here you can see that inulin actually reduces the production of these branched-chain fatty acids from protein fermentation, even in the presence of iron, and also reduces ammonia, even in the presence of iron, compared to the iron situation here. On inulin, we always see a huge increase in lactate, which I won't dwell upon anymore. But we also saw a decrease in all these phenolic components, where inulin drastically reduced the production of these phenolic components. Now, I have a little anecdote. When I was a PhD student, I was not really clever. It doesn't mean I'm clever now, but at least then I wasn't. I'm a molecular biologist. You know, I isolate DNA from bacterial cultures, and to purify that, you do a phenochloroform extraction. And I would not always wear gloves. So if you get a little drop of phenol on your skin, like that, my fingers are a little bit moist, like that, you get a blister. You can see the blister coming up. So imagine you've got microbes producing all these related phenolic compounds in your gastrointestinal tract, and what that must do to your epithelial cells. It's really, really toxic. So reducing the production of these toxic components is really, really important, particularly in these chronic kidney disease patients, because those toxins, when they end up in plasma, five more minutes, when they end up in plasma, they are not cleared by the kidney, because these patients do not have a functioning kidney. Remember the picture of the videos of these two rats? Well, we actually went into and studied the gut microbiota composition of these rats. And you can see that on the basis of the control rat or the autistic rat, there's a clear difference in gut microbiota composition. So we are very interested in this and see if we can figure out which microbes we may use also in autistic human individuals to modify their gut microbiota composition. So if you look at that, green is control, and red is in the autistic red. So there are a lot of different microorganisms that are actually changed in the autistic red compared to control. You can actually translate that into function, and this is at a high abstract level, where, and these are p-values, where there is significant changes in a number of different overall functions of the gut microbiota between control and autistic animals. In view of time, I'll be very brief on this. Actually, I want to go to this one, because I promised it. What we have done here is we have used substrates that were labeled with a stable isotope. Okay, so a stable isotope, not a radioactive isotope. Stable isotopes you can actually safely use in humans. So inulin was completely labeled with carbon-13, and we gave it to the gut microbiota and looked at production of short-chain fatty acids, because those contain energy. So acetate has two carbon atoms, so it can have one label or two. Propionate can have one, two, or three. Butyrate, one, two, three, or four, although we didn't see the one with three. If you sum that up and multiply that with kilocalories per mole, then the total amount of energy extracted by the gut microbiota from inulin is 2.05 kilocals per gram. If you look in the literature, it says 2. Okay, so very close to 2. However, if you take 1 gram of lactose, it is 2.41. If you take 1 gram of starch, it's 1.69. So there's actually quite some variation. And the literature value of 2 is a theoretical value. So we can show that depending on the substrate, the energy harvest of the body by the uptake of these short-chain fatty acids is actually depending on the gut microbiota. So that may be why, you know, my microbiota extracts more energy. And the reason I wanted to show this is the next one. So just suppose, as a thought experiment, that we eat lactose instead of starch, which are the two extremes in the previous slide. And the intake is about 20 grams per day, which actually is a conservative intake. That's not very much. Then over a period of 10 years, the microbiota has extracted in the form of short-chain fatty acids an additional 7 kilograms of body weight, okay? So that's just a single example of different substrates and how that may lead to extraction of more or less energy from dietary components. Okay, so in that example where I showed the pectins and galacto-oligosaccharide and lactose, where the difference seems to be quite small, over a long period of time, that actually is kilograms of body weight. All right. Okay, now this can be very quick. I've been working with these models almost for 20 years. But we know that they have limitations. There are no feedback mechanisms, although we do control pH and volume. But for instance, if we ingest the meal high in fat, our body will respond by secreting additional bile. TIM does not do that unless we program it. So we need the proper liturgy data for that. Also, we have no interaction with the host. We have no mucosal cells, no immune cells. But we can combine it with other biological models. We can take biopsies, or we can culture KCO2 cells or immunocompetent cells in these microtiter plates and interact with TIM samples to get an even better prediction of health. So with that, I'd like to conclude that these validated in vitro models of the GI tract are great tools to understand the effect of pro and prebiotics on the gut microbiota, both composition and activity, and they actually may predict the health outcome in man, and I should add to that, and animals, despite the inherent limitations that the model has. So for more information, these are two of my many email addresses. I'd like to thank you very much for your attention with some nice Dutch tulips, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you. Regarding the disease that you presented for us, I would like to know what the risk of someone develops this disease using antibiotics.
Yes, that actually is a very interesting question, because antibiotics really change the gut microbiota composition. The theory of Martin Blaser in the U.S. is that antibiotics actually caused some of our microorganisms to disappear over a number of generations and might be the reason why we have all these Western diseases. In chronic kidney disease patients, antibiotics may actually change the gut microbiota composition drastically, may actually lead to production of toxic metabolites that they can't handle, so there actually is quite a risk. Some of the follow-up experiments that we want to do is combine antibiotics with prebiotics or probiotics to see if we can prevent that change in gut microbiota composition.
Good morning. I don't quite understood how you feed the team with the material you collect from humans, and you replicate them. Do they pass through the system just once, and you have to collect in each moment? How does it work? Because I'm a vet, and we have more ways to collect the material. Even though nowadays with the welfare we have reduced it, but we already have the data. So many things you have shown, like the pH, it's absolutely a thing that will maybe answer some of your questions. That with the how do they the lactobacillus and other bacteria associated, how do they improve? Because maybe they can stabilize the pH and reduce the increase of pathogenic bacteria.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure what you mean with what material we collect. Do you mean fecal material or?
Do you use only fecal material to go run through TIM?
So the fecal material is introduced into TIM 2, okay? In TIM 1, we actually don't really have a microbiota, and that is because certainly in humans, the proportion of microbes that is present in the small intestine compared to the colon is a factor of 10 or 100,000. So in pigs, it's different. They actually have quite a number of bacteria also in the small intestine. But the data that we have collected, the parameters that we mimic, come from literature data where people were used that had these tubes inserted and then pH measured or enzyme concentration measured, or nowadays you actually have a little pill with a camera that you can swallow, and I can also measure some of these parameters. And on the basis of the literature data, we set up all of our protocols. So I mentioned that for humans we have babies, adults, and elderly, but within those we have different protocols for a glass of water, glass of milk, yogurt. We have a what we call a European continental breakfast. We have something that we call an Asian type breakfast, but I have recently I got a Chinese student and he says, well, there is no Asian type breakfast. Every country has a different one, so we have to rename that. But anyway, we have all these different types of breakfast for which we have data and parameters on how, on average, in a population, it travels through the GI tract.
Thank you.
You very nice talk, Kun, as always. I was wondering if you have tried to mimic what is currently going on in anorexic patients, where you stop the supply of nutrients in your team two. What will happen to the microbiota?
Yeah, that's a very interesting one. We have submitted a grant to look at that. It's a grant that goes through two cycles, so we passed the first cycle. The student that submitted actually has an interview on June 22nd to see if she actually gets the grant, but yeah, we do want to look at that too.
Great, it's nice, because I think there is nothing currently published on this area.
Not a lot, no.
And not on these in vitro systems, for sure.
No.
Thank you for your presentation. What are toxophenolic compounds for the probiotics and microbiota?
Well, these phenolic compounds are primarily toxic for ourselves, although having said that, polyphenols are actually also antimicrobial, so it really depends on the structure. The thing with polyphenols is that actually the gut microbiota also breaks them down into more simple phenolic structures, and some of these may actually have bioactivity. We've shown one of these compounds to be anti-cancerous. So it really kind of depends on the structure of the molecule, whether it's antimicrobial or can stimulate certain bacteria or, yeah. So it's not an easy question to answer.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you, Professor.
You're welcome.
Okay. So now I will turn to Portuguese, okay? Bom, pessoal, então algumas informações importantes. Agora a gente sai para o almoço e o nosso horário de retorno é às 14h. Só que aí essa nosso workshop ele divide-se em dois. Então, alimentos vai continuar nessa sala, que é o L12, e veterinária vai para o L, deixa eu confirmar, 44. Que é muito perto aqui, na verdade, é só contornar e no próximo corredor, ao L44. Nós teremos também a participação de duas turmas de graduação a partir das tardes de hoje e amanhã. Então, a gente vai ter, a audiência vai ficar bem maior. E então, eles também podem escolher qual sala eles preferem, mas talvez eles venham para alimentos, porque são do curso de nutrição, são das disciplinas de microbiologia e higiene, e de alimentos funcionais, então possivelmente eles viram para cá. Mas a gente também vai fazer uma transmissão simultânea para outra sala, que é a OL42, certo? Então, para o pessoal da graduação, podem vir, ocupar os lugares vagos, e aí, acabando esses locais, eles irão para outra sala, que é a 42. O coffee da tarde vai ser servido da veterinária, que é a 44, certo? Bom, o que mais? Nós enviamos e-mail com a ordem de apresentação. Ordem, eu digo assim, qual o dia de apresentação dos pôsteres, certo? E para as apresentações orais, a gente também fez uma comunicação com esses autores, né? E depois a gente fez essa comunicação em bloco para novamente confirmar os dias de apresentação dos trabalhos. Então, caso alguém não tenha recebido, existe uma forma de conferir isso. Vou pedir ajuda da Fabiola para entrar na internet. Porque o livro de resumos ele já está disponível, dessa vez não é CD, a gente ficou um pouquinho mais moderno. Então, nós fizemos um PDF e ele está disponível na página da FCA, que é essa unidade aqui onde nós estamos. Então, entrando na página, o endereço é www.fca.unicamp.br. Vocês podem entrar na aba pós-graduação, porque esse evento está sendo também apoiado pelo programa especificamente aqui, da Ciência da Nutrição, Esporte e Metabolismo. Ai, a página está diferente. Ah, ok. Pós-graduação, aí tem eventos dentro. Coincidentemente, a página está sendo atualizada agora, essa semana, eu acho, porque semana passada eu entrei e estava diferente. Aí, em eventos, mas eventos dentro de pós-graduação. Ah. Desce um pouquinho. Ok. Então, a gente tem aqui o link direto para o livro de resumos. Então, ele já está aí, tem um PDF, vocês podem entrar e acessar. Temos resumos das palestras e depois os trabalhos científicos das áreas de alimentos e veterinária. Assim que eu recebi esse livro de resumos, que foi, na verdade, a versão final na semana passada, se eu não estou enganada, eu fiz um pedido do ISBN. Só que esse pedido demora um pouquinho, pelo menos uns 15 a 20 dias, porque para algumas carreiras é importante que tenha o ISBN, então ele vai demorar um pouquinho. Assim que estiver disponível, a gente vai atualizar essa versão com o número do ISBN para quem precisa disso, certo? É um pouco cedo para falar isso, mas os certificados eles serão entregues depois, eletronicamente. A gente vai, isso vai nos tomar assim, pelo menos uns 30 dias, no máximo, ok, para enviar os certificados para todos vocês, certo? Bom, então, sobre os trabalhos ainda, quem trouxe o banner e quer sair para almoçar e deixar o banner aqui, vocês têm essa opção, falando com o Luiz, que é aquele moço simpático lá atrás, ok? Então, se vocês quiserem, ele vai anotar, quem deixar, ele vai anotar, certo? E aí fica aqui, o horário de apresentação é às 14h, porém, a partir do meio-dia, a gente já tem acesso à sala, que eu tenho que ver qual que é agora. Você lembra de cabeça? Às 4, que horas que eu falei? Desculpa, às 4. Não, 14. Certo, gente? Então, a UL14 é a continuação dessa aqui. A gente está na 12. Então, a 14, para lá, né? Inclusive, eu dou aula lá, já estou meio esquecida. Então, a apresentação dos posters vai ser lá. Não tem nenhuma ordem, vocês podem escolher. A gente vai usar esse modelo aqui de tripé, então vocês podem escolher o que vocês quiserem. Quem tiver trazido dois, ele tem dois lados, inclusive, se quiser aproveitar o mesmo, vocês que escolhem. Tá certo? Bom, a gente vai dar algumas dicas também, quem vai sair para almoçar, e eu vou pedir para a Fabiola ajudar, que ela sabe mais disso que eu.
Bom dia a todos. Estou aqui em Limeira há muito tempo, né? Então, venho acompanhando o crescimento da cidade, e sei dar algumas dicas aí, posso ajudar, me coloco à disposição, se vocês precisarem de alguma direção. Mas, basicamente, aqui nós temos o restaurante da universidade, que disponibiliza aí uma refeição para o visitante. Creio que o valor está em torno de R$ 16,00, e vocês podem ir diretamente aqui, só descer por entre os prédios, há uma escada, e vocês vão ver logo à direita o restaurante. O cardápio também está disponível lá, e no caixa vocês podem se informar como realiza o pagamento, se desejarem participar da refeição lá. Existem aqui no entorno da FCA algumas opções também. Logo aqui em frente, subindo a escadaria, tem uma praça. Em frente a essa praça, existe um lugar que vende salgados e tapioca, conhecido como Cantinho da Tapioca. Se vocês preferirem um lanche mais rápido, lá é uma das opções. Aqui, saindo aqui em frente, na lateral, existe um restaurante chamado Praia. Também serve almoço lá, com opções, inclusive, para vegetarianos. Existe essa opção. E, seguindo a rua desse restaurante Praia, existe um mercado, chama Santa Rita. se alguém preferir fazer alguma compra, comprar algum alimento mais fácil, mais rápido, também tem essa outra opção. Existe um outro restaurante perto da FT, que é bem mais para frente nessa rua, seguindo mesmo, que é o Augustas. Vocês podem também chegar ali próximo e solicitar a localização. É uma outra opção com self-service. Então, a equipe também está à disposição, não só eu, todo mundo que tem esse crachá azul pode direcionar caso necessário.
Obrigada, Fabíola. Eu esqueci só de explicar, é uma pena que eu não estou com o material aqui, mas me parece que os trabalhos, os banners, é até o número 16. Você lembra disso? Ah, ele tem lá. Até que número hoje? 14. Só que essa informação vocês só vão conseguir ver no livro, tá? Porque a gente não passou essa informação previamente. Mas se vocês acompanharem lá pelo livro, vocês vão conseguir ver em que ordem. Eu imagino que todos receberam, mas vá que alguém não tenha recebido. De qualquer forma, se alguém trouxe o banner hoje e quiser apresentar hoje, também não tem problema, certo? Aí a gente vai só fazer a conferência de que realmente apresentou para depois mandar o certificado de apresentação do trabalho, ok? Alguma dúvida, pessoal? Sim. Ah, então, olha só, eu ia explicar isso mais tarde, mas vamos lá. A gente tem um horário bem folgado de almoço, de café, desculpa, de coffee, que é das 3 às 4. Então, eu proponho que a gente, a partir desse horário das 3, já vai ter o pessoal do apoio para ajudar, mas é necessário que vocês estejam lá. Eu quero dar uns 10, 15 minutinhos para as pessoas poderem, de qualquer forma, ir ao banheiro, lavar a mão, enfim. Então, a partir das 15 minutos passados, né, 4h15, aí começa oficialmente a apresentação dos trabalhos. Certo? Mas quem já quiser ir antes, fique à vontade, é porque 50 minutos de exposição de trabalho também é um pouco cansativo, não precisa ficar todo esse tempo, mas pelo menos a partir das 4h15. Certo? Mais alguma pergunta? Bom, então, bom almoço a todos, a gente se encontra daqui a pouco. Okay?